You may think us Amish are strange and old-fashioned folk. What with our buggies, beards, and barn raisings. But to tell you the truth, we feel pretty blessed with the richness of our lives.
Wow.
Last year, 5 of our Amish teenagers were invited to experience life in Great Britain. Now we'd like to show some hospitality back and welcome some young English folk to come share in the pleasures of our Amish life.
Good morning, guys.
My name's Jonathan, and my wife Marietta and I were most privileged to be the first to host our British friends. Over the next few weeks, they'll stay with several different brethren, from Pennsylvania to Ohio, to get a true taste of just how us plain folk live. I just know we're all in for a treat. This week, our 6 British teenage friends are heading to a town called Ashland in Ohio to stay with the Burkholder family.
Aw, they look smiley. I like smiley people.
The Burkholders are plain people like ourselves who live by the name of the Lord. And just like us Amish, they love big families. The Burkholder family has 10
nice
members.
I'm Rachel.
Harvey. Good morning. I'm Harvey.
Hi, Halsey. Nice to meet you. I'm Sienna.
Okay. Hi.
I'm Darlene.
I'm Charlotte.
Charlotte. What's your name?
James.
Okay, I'm Darlene.
It's so nice to meet you.
Hello.
We were looking forward to this day.
Yeah, and welcome to the Burkholder family. It's nice to have you, and we have rooms for you here.
And work.
And work. And as you noticed, I do go barefoot, and I
it's not comfortable in shoes.
We speak Pennsylvania Dutch, and normally we try to speak English when we have visitors. So if you hear us speak an off language, it's Pennsylvania Dutch. And we're not talking about you.
The Burkholders are what we call Old Order Mennonites. Back in the 1600s, we were all the same group. Then in 1693, we split because the Mennonites wanted to modernize. But as you can see, the Old Order Mennonites haven't modernized that much, and they look pretty similar to us. However, look closely, and you can spot some tiny differences.
In the Amish houses we went before, they didn't have much on the walls and stuff, so it's quite decorative.
The house is really big as well, there's lots of space.
Yeah,
it's a big house, yes.
So this is the room where the boys would be staying in.
Oh, nice.
This is the room where you get to stay and lounge, whatever you need to do to get rested.
What do you think of what we're wearing now?
You're dressed, what I mean, I don't know what to say. When he stepped out of the van, I said, that looks like an Amish.
No, see, in our church, the guys wouldn't be allowed to have long hair.
They aren't allowed to have any beards or anything.
Should me and Jordan shave?
You wouldn't dare come to church like this. Okay. Would you always wear your hair like this with a band?
No, normally it's a lot longer. I got it cut at an Amish house.
I'm going to thank that Amish for doing that.
Okay, this is going to be your room now. These are your outfits, and you can see the names. Oh, they are. Did you get that one?
Oh,
they're so different.
I don't know what to say.
This is exciting.
I actually love the
patterns. Compared to the Amish dresses we wore, which were just really dark and really boring.
Mennonites always wore the patterns, and the Amish stayed original. They stayed with the solid colors.
So that's a really nice color.
It does. It goes nice. Whoever picked the colors is a good choice, I think.
I actually really like it. Look at this. Looks like I made a big effort.
We usually aren't allowed to wear makeup, so might be a good idea to take it off, huh? Is it something you like would wear all the time, pretty much, or?
Yeah, it makes me feel prettier. And I like to feel pretty.
Sure. The earrings, is that something you wear all the time?
Yeah, it's just something I really like. Weirdly, I enjoy getting my ears pierced. Uh-huh. Do you ever have ear piercings?
No, it wouldn't be allowed with the church.
Must admit, Darlene, quite nice. Oh. It's good looking, to be honest. I'll put it out there.
Like, obviously, we'll see what the kind of mood is like. But I see no reason why you shouldn't ask her on a date.
Take her out in the buggy?
Yeah. Yeah, I think so.
I mean, don't. I wouldn't trust you behind.
I think you should.
I'm obviously not going to propose to her.
No, they want to get to...
Asking out dates, pretty awkward.
Hello.
Hi. You three girls can sit here if you'd like.
Perfect.
I think your colours all fit your complexion.
Trying on the new outfits the first time was quite exciting, just because we haven't seen colour in a long time. But there is a limit to colour. I mean, this is nice, but I feel a little explosive.
You can see they come out of a city. That was my first thing. I noticed the one had real long hair. I noticed the ring. If I was home on a Sunday morning and somebody would come to my door wearing a ring, long hair, I'd probably lock the door. But we thought, we're going to overlook this. We can't see their heart. We don't know what's in their heart. George is the one, just by looking at him, I'd say he's good at sound. I wouldn't think that he would be any harm. The other one is kind of iffy.
Hello. Holy shave.
You're all dressed up and you're shaved and you look like farmers.
This is totally new for them to be this close to someone with sort of lip piercings and stuff like that. And I think, you know, first impressions is everything, but I wouldn't change the way I am.
The Old Order Mennonites make all their own clothes, and Marnita and Darlene thought it would be fun to take the English girls to their fabric store. This means our city lasses need to get to grips with our plainer mode of transportation.
All right, paddle, 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 paddle. Okay, go, 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 go. Keep on paddling. Keep straight, keep straight. Keep on. Make a circle of the yard. Nick, keep on.
Bikes are a contentious mode of transport for us Amish. Many of our groups don't allow them, but the Old Order Mennonites love a good cycle ride.
Sienna's going for it. Come on, Sienna!
We plain people dress plain. We don't like anything to distract us from what is pure and modest. However, the Old Order Mennonites are allowed to wear floral prints. A little wilder than the norm, but there the wildness stops. Their dresses all conform to the same dress pattern.
This one or this one?
If it was for me, I'd go for this. It's a matter of preference, really.
It depends on what color you want to bring out, because this here would bring out more the blue version of it.
That's the color. I'd say that looks good.
What are your favorite colors and patterns, then?
Wild stuff. I really don't know bright, colorful stuff.
Does your mum let you get whatever fabric you like, really?
Not at all. Because I like stuff with big flowers, but we aren't allowed to have those. We'll try to stay with more, like, the medium to small prints, so you don't, like, in a crowd, everybody's like, oh, who's that girl? She's got a really wild dress on, you know? What's she trying to be?
That would be interesting, actually, because I'd wear something completely different from my friends to stand out. Shopping is a big thing in my life. I could go shopping every day. Look at this.
I like this.
Thank you. Probably all my money goes on clothes, to be honest.
Hold on, a lot of it goes on makeup.
And makeup.
She feels she needs to be wearing lots of makeup all the time.
When I was younger, I was a bit of a chunky monkey, really. I was a bit of a big kid. And I think with people judging me, the makeup kind of acted as a disguise. It's kind of a mask that I have to put on to have this confidence. I do take quite a while getting ready for a night out. Obviously, when you grow up, you want to look older and you take more time in your appearance because you want to impress the guys. Probably my friends, I suppose, I'm influenced by what they like doing. They like going out partying and stuff, and I'll go along with that as well. Intentionally, you do kind of want to attract male attention because you just feel better in yourself. If you can kind of pull on the night out, it's just kind of one up on you because you've managed to get a guy. And I don't like that because I'm quite scared, I suppose, of talking to boys in a way. I'm quite nervy because I never know what to say and I never know what they make of me. My dresses would probably come up to about here. Mm-hmm. And I'd have high heels and I'd kind of, you know, get my legs out.
And it makes me feel kind of good. I don't know. I think I'd like that.
It probably depends, too, on like, the places you go, you know, if you want to fit in. Like, for us, personality is what stands out. We wouldn't exactly try to draw attention with the clothes, maybe, put it that way.
As well as running a fabric store, the Burkholders have their own melon farm. Old Order Mennonites don't own cars, but they do own tractors. They see them as friendly technology, which helps their communities to harvest food from the rich Ohio soil.
I need to drive tractor.
One of us will drive the tractor. Well, neither of us know how.
If you can drive a car, you will know how to drive a tractor.
David is 24, and he's been working the soil since he was 5.
I mean, the first year I ran tillage equipment and tractors, I was 12, which is pretty young, but I guess Dad trusted me. I don't know. I loved it. It's a very good life. You're your own boss. It's kind of a family thing. Me and my brother and Dad worked together. We love it. We love it.
The Old Order Mennonites cherished the family thing. But I get the kind of feeling that life isn't quite the same for George back home.
For me, it is quite different because I've been to boarding school since I was 10. So for about 8 months of the year, I'm in Eton, 250 miles away from my parents.
It was always my parents' decision. For them, it was kind of Eton or nothing.
I feel that it's giving him a real sense of his own individuality. I think when they're away at school, he can think who George is rather than George just being number two out of four boys. Excuse me, the dog's just disappearing. Coco, here! Coco, come on! Coco, here!
You know, being away from your parents can be quite difficult.
It means I don't have as much of a chance to build up, like, a close relationship.
Listen, I would like you to come and stay at home a little bit during the holiday. Do you think you can give me a couple of days either side?
Yeah, no, I will. I'll be back, like, late July. But I wanna, like, see people and stuff like that.
My mum gets quite frustrated, definitely, with my lack of presence, I guess.
It's interesting to see, they share with the Amish that same sort of family value system of, you know, the family being the most important thing. And I think the farm is kind of like a glue that holds the family together.
These guys seem very happy and very content, so I think it seems to be a good thing.
All the hard work we put into the fields ends up here, on the dinner table. Meal times are a chance for us to get together, be with our families, and discuss the important things in life.
So we've got Mountain Dew energy.
How do you evaluate, or how do you look at happiness, or what is happiness to you?
Oh, it's such a big question, Navi. Why?
I'll help you out a little bit. Okay. I think you're always happy.
I think maybe to live, laugh, and love, maybe. Like being able to sort of live freely.
George?
I don't know, I think I'm really struggling with it.
We get a lot of happiness from our simple, holy way of life. In fact, there's nothing more joyful than Mama Rachel's harmonica shindig. The harmonica is one of the few instruments us plain people are allowed to play. It's a good way to exercise our country lungs. Perhaps not so easy for the city folk.
That's on the high side, it's on the low. Yeah, that's better.
Okay. I know.
Having fun with the family really lifts the spirits. But of course, what gives us true happiness is being at one with God and reading the Lord's Word. A week ago, Charlotte vowed to read his most sacred and beautiful work from beginning to end.
Yeah, it's kind of quite long-winded, and there is a lot of pages to read. And I still don't really understand, you know, all these names and stuff. It's a lot of rules. It's a lot of things to read up on. So I'm actually still on Genesis. Probably should have got a bit further by now. But I can't. See, Genesis 1 couldn't really get my head around that, so I'm worried that as I go on further into it, you know, what's going to happen then? I might get totally confused by the whole thing. But no, I'm not going to give up, actually. I'm going to try and see where it takes me. I have been praying to God, though, and getting my thoughts out of my head. And I think kind of my prayers are kind of being answered in a way, because I'm, you know, saying to God that I want to say how I feel and kind of get on with the Amish, and I feel like I'm doing that. So maybe he is answering my prayers quite subtly.
The Burkholder family come from an order of plain people known as the Horse and Buggy Mennonites. And you can probably tell why. We worry that cars bring us close to temptation. And so we prefer to go the simple, slow way.
This makes me feel like I'm out of period drama now.
Love thy neighbor, the Bible tells us, and we couldn't agree more. We like to come together in good times and bad and let each other know how much we care.
Hello.
Today, the girls are taking time off from their chores to join a scrapbook party.
Making cards for a special occasion.
We had talked about making some for a boy that fell down from a construction job and broke both his wrists.
That's cool. Nice to know you're being thought of.
Yes. You just pick a card that you would like to make and we'll help you.
This is what we call a scrapbook shower, and it's one of the ways our ladies like to party.
You know, when I come home and my husband asks, what were you doing today? I might have a card or two to show him. Then he knows I just wasn't just talking.
Talking's good.
I'm going to make this for my dad.
The first man a girl falls in love with is her daddy. Yeah, he does a lot for me, so I think.
For some people, like Margaret, a scrapbook can really make a difference to their lives.
What is the scrapbook kind of about?
It has verses of inspiration, sometimes longer poems, sometimes just short verses. My husband, he had cancer, and so we really appreciated all the scrapbooks that we got, and I think there's over 500. If I was feeling blue about everything, I just had to look at those, and it kept me floating through hard times. He eventually improved, you know, and now we have those scrapbooks as a memory of that time, I guess.
It's really touched me, actually. I didn't think a card would, you know, touch me as much. They're all very personal, and obviously they spend a lot of time on that, so it really shows, you know, that they care.
To Daddy Cool, I hope you've had time to refuel your batteries. I really have realised the amount of time and effort you put into allowing me to live my life just the way I like it. All the love in the world, Shah.
They're the cute. He'll definitely feel love when he gets that.
Right, okay, so this is the outside, very adult. And then we go in and it's like, BAM!
It's funny they call this a party. If I'm not dancing, then it's not a party, quite simply. But it's funny because I often have a quite a firm idea of what I find fun. And it kind of emphasises the fact that party means that just getting together, really. That's the main idea. And there was no alcohol, there's no smoking, there was nothing, no sort of shenanigans with the opposite sex or whatever. It was literally just a group of female friends getting together, doing something quite innocent and a good way to spend a good few hours, really.
Us plain people love to live simple, pray simple, and work simple. It would seem George has been taking this all in, and the plain living lifestyle has got him thinking and wanting to know more.
I always enjoyed this life. I just love it. We were born that way and we live here, and it's all we ever known. And I mean, I always loved raising plants and crops, and I guess it was my blood, and I just love it.
So what about the faster pace of life?
I don't know. If I have a job, work in an office all day, and kids be home fighting, and I mean, soon they won't get along with each other, and well, 40 years down the road, where are they going to be? But where am I going to be? I mean, it's home was always back on the farm. I wouldn't want it any other way.
How many bad days do you have a year?
I don't know. I would have guessed probably 10, but I have no idea. I mean, I don't know. Just look at the bright things in life, and I don't know. The rest of the day goes better. I don't know. How many bad days do you have in a year?
You know, it's hard to kind of qualify what a bad day actually is, but I'd say at least twice a week, probably. So that really starts to add up, I think. Probably maybe at least 100, probably. I don't know.
Okay. Well, that's kind of interesting. I thought, yeah, as the happiest-go-luckiest person in the batch. I was surprised to hear that from you, but...
For me, and for like, I know a lot of my friends as well do feel very pressurized by their parents and having to go to the, you know, be number one and be at the top university and be at the top of the class and stuff like that. And obviously, there are so many doors open at the moment that I could, you know, choose to pursue many different career paths and stuff if I wanted to. But I'm relatively clueless as to what path I want to choose.
If I knew American history, then I can go.
What American history would you do?
Wild West, American Civil War. That's pretty cool.
I think that's one of those sort of funny subjects that universities aren't that impressed with, or employers aren't that impressed with. Cowboys and Indians.
You
and when you get to New York, you...
Ned, by the way.
Why? You got top exam prize.
You're kidding, Ned. You got the maths prize. In the entire year?
Yeah.
How big is the year?
Well, 30.
That's not bad.
There is a weight in the sense that you don't want to look like you wasted your time at the school because you are kind of bestowed with all these opportunities. So I try and do as best as I can.
What are your predicted grades, George?
I think I'm predicted 3 A's. I think at the moment I'm finding quite hard just to kind of stay on top of work. It all just kind of builds up, and before you know it, you're staying up to like 2-3 in the morning just drilling into this mountain of work.
I just look on the bright side of life. If there's somebody that needs help, I mean, like I said, if your brother needs a buck, give him 20 bucks. I mean, I've never met a greedy person in my lifetime that's happy. I mean, it's just the more they get, the more they want, and the grouchier they get. I guess that might be another right reason I like the simple life. I don't know. But I think someday you'll think about that. You cannot make happiness. Happiness comes from within. There's just no two ways about it.
On Sunday nights, our young Old Order Mennonite folk leave their homes to come and socialize in what's called the youth group. This is how they like to party in the evenings. They sing, play volleyball, and if they're lucky, get to meet that special someone.
So is this how kind of spend your time getting together with everyone and meeting guys?
Yeah, this is usually what our parties with Sunday night.
I love how you call it parties, like a party back in England.
It's a party.
Yeah, like mad and yeah. I like to dance. And I suppose it's nice if you attract the boys.
It's really fun.
How many times do you get to see your boyfriends?
Saturday evenings and then Sunday evenings again when we have our date.
Saturday evenings we talk maybe for about a half an hour, like after the singing. Mm-hmm. And then Sunday evenings it's 5 hours.
5 hours?
Yes.
You constantly chat for the 5 hours then?
Oh no.
I mean, there's always times that there's... I mean, you can't just talk all the time, I guess. Sometimes you have to think about what you're going to say next.
Yeah. Think about what you said.
Yeah, if you said it right or not.
And they say silence is golden too, so...
Yeah.
With the girls, I just really like talking about dating because they all seem kind of really innocent about it and they're all quite giggly. You know, they don't seem that confident with talking to guys and stuff because they seem to be quite separated. It's quite formal, you know, they have to do a 5-hour date and the time they spend together is really for getting to know each other. And I find back in England that sometimes, you know, you don't really get to know the person that well. It's just kind of on the surface, it's only kind of skin deep. But perhaps here they really do take time to get to know who you are inside.
Hey, James. How are you doing?
The way we plain folk begin our courtship appears to be sparking some interest among our young British friends.
Why did you meet your wife?
We were in the same youth group of about approximately 180 youth. So I wrote her a letter and requested if she would want to be in a relationship with me, and she answered with a letter in return as we started dating.
What did you actually write? Was you quite sort of open with your feelings towards her, sort of from the off?
It was only a couple lines long. I mean, usually if you write a letter requesting a relationship of a girl, they generally know that you put a lot of thought, prayers into that thought before you actually write those words and send it in the mail. So if you were back home in England, how would you go about asking a girl for a courtship?
Back in London, James doesn't have a Christian youth group to help him find a wife. Instead, he has a friend called Jack.
She's nice.
We're basically at the bridge where I like to take my dates. It's kind of romantic a bit.
I've heard that nearly 8 million people live in the same place. So you'd think it would be easy finding the right partner.
Oh, that one.
Then again, perhaps not.
I find it hard to approach girls, though, so I sent Jack out.
Basically, I have to sort of, like, get it started for him. And then I sort of just leave him on the spot, and then I just go away.
Well, once he's got it started, I'm all right.
And then I have to come on the dates and...
No, it's only with that one girl. In our society, it's quite... People do use their cars to maybe impress the girls. How'd you do that with your buggy?
It's not... Usually don't try to make it too obvious, but some guys do. In my case, I did make it kind of obvious. This is like a crushed velvet interior, and also have a sunroof up here. And that one, that was also custom built.
You have a touchscreen in
here? Yes, I have a touchscreen in here to control my lighting system. The strip lights on the side, if I turn those on. We're required by law to have flashers of some sort, but I got a couple more than some of the buggies. And I also have some underbody lights on it. And with a stereo system, it would flash with the beat and all that. I never got to work with the horse's hoof beats, but I always thought it would be pretty wild. Were you jealous?
Just a bit. And you've got a provisional, and he's pimping out his buggy.
Why does he do it like that? For the girls?
No, he's not actually for the girls. It does obviously help a bit, but it's not intentionally for the girls. And then it had this Ferrari.
What?
At the Ferrari horse logo on the metal mudguard. This is something that I've never ever associated with Mennonites in it, pimping out their car, the buggy. It's getting more and more modern, but you're keeping the core value of the horse.
You're still sitting behind that horse and still driving that horse at 10 miles an hour. So I need to take my wife home. She's tired and we're going to head for home.
I definitely think that having that type of buggy will definitely increase your chances of getting a date. They class dating as a relationship, whereas dates are quite casual back home. You might go out for a date and, like, by the end of the date, you snog their face off. It doesn't fit me much, I guess.
The good book tells us, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. Our cornfields may not quite be the Garden of Eden, but it's the land that we harvest and care for.
Are these for lunch, then?
Yep, these are for lunch.
And would you say a lot of your food is kind of self-produced?
Probably, during the summer months, 75% of the food is self-produced.
Would you say you're content in the farming lifestyle?
Yes, very, very much content.
Why is it that farming makes you so happy?
You can be happy in whatever you do. The key to happiness is love. If you don't have love, opposite of love is anger, and anger is depression. If we live in anger or if we live in doubt, if a person lives in doubt, he can't be happy.
So do you feel like having a simpler life is a key to happiness then?
A simple lifestyle plays a big part in happiness because stuff will not bring happiness. The more you gain, the more you have, the more you want. Being content where you are and what you have.
David said yesterday that like happiness comes from within.
Exactly. 100% true. There's still plenty power in the precious blood. There's still power
in the blood of the Lamb. I think to meet someone who claims he only has 10 bad days a year, it just sounds mind-blowing. But I didn't even know if that was, like, you know, possible. Being content for them is being pleased with what you've got and not being envious of what others have. I think for me, I'm always kind of wanting more, and I never feel like I'm content with what I have. It's funny, I've never actually thought, like... I've never actually had, like, a serious think about what I want in life and stuff. And, like, what the bare minimum for me would be in terms of job or family life or who I am.
And of course, there's no denying that a key part of our happiness is in finding our life partner. This couldn't be done without the parlor, a specific room that exists in every Mennonite household and only used for courtship conversations. This is the eldest daughter's domain. She can decorate it to her taste and entertain her special guests there. And when she gets engaged, it passes to her younger sister.
Pretty.
Once you're dating, that's where you have your dates, like Sunday night dates. Yeah, basically.
How comes you wouldn't, you know, just use your bedroom? Why do you have another room for stuff like that?
Well, if we have our dates in our bedroom, I think we'd be tempted to take it farther than just a basic relationship.
I don't know, maybe because our houses tend to be a bit smaller, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. But we tend to just have a bedroom and, you know, we would just go to our room and that's our personal space. Yeah. Do you know anyone where their boyfriends would stay over at all?
Oh, no. Not at all. Zero.
No.
In our society, sometimes I feel that the boys kind of want you to perhaps have sex quicker than you feel ready. Do you kind of have that peer pressure into kind of lose your virginity or...?
There's nothing. No. Zero. It's just something you don't talk about, really. Mm-hmm.
Is it really important for you that you take it as a, you know, slow pace and you really kind of soak up what you mean to each other then?
Yes, very. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of choice if you want to keep your purity. It depends on, I guess, on how strong you feel on that subject. Mm. To the majority of the people, it's not important anymore to keep your purity, to wait until after marriage, and therefore marriage is kind of lost art, really. I mean, it's, yeah, it still happens, but, you know, anymore you hear so many people, they're not getting married until after they've had a couple kids, you know, and it's just kind of, it's really sad if you really think about it.
I think keeping yourself pure shows how strong the relationship can be if you can wait.
Mm.
And I just wish, you know, back at home it would be like that. Because relationships should mean everything, and it's just lost.
Mm.
And, you know, sometimes perhaps they don't even get to know the person they're kind of with.
It's very much on the surface, I think, some of
very
it.
Very much.
You know,
on aesthetics. It's not deep within, you know. It does frustrate me, actually.
If you're a virgin in England, it's kind of like, ooh, you're a bit weird. Whereas here, if you're not a virgin, you're just like, you know, it's disgusting. Whereas we have the pressure to have sex.
Yeah.
They very much have the pressure to not have sex.
To me, it seems a perfect way of dating.
Mm-mm.
And I do envy it. I actually really do envy it.
You may have noticed that we plain people cherish our marriages and our families. They're the cornerstone of our communities. And the closeness of our community provides us much comfort and normally protects us from the world's more surprising experiences.
A lot of people seem to judge me quite early on because of my appearance. I was wondering sort of what was your sort of first appearances of me?
Well, a lot of people kind of judge you probably by your long hair.
My long hair.
Probably the band around your head.
Yeah.
Okay. They probably looked at that and thought, is he really going to help on the farm? The thing that's on your lip, is it the peer from your friends?
Not really, because a lot of them don't actually like it.
Okay.
But my mom was sort of quite supportive of me getting it, and she actually came with me to get it done.
Okay, so your mom was not against it?
No, she wasn't against it. But you know, had I got it done, and you know, she said that she didn't like it, and she wanted it out, and I would have
then
took it out.
Then you would have made a different decision, probably. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well.
I was wondering, I asked sort of your eldest daughter sort of for a date, and it's sort of the first time you've seen, and I turned up with obviously my hair long. I'm guessing that you wouldn't let her go on a date with me.
We would probably share with her. Could you ask him to cut his hair?
Mm-hmm.
Could you ask him to take the ring out of his lip?
Mm-hmm.
We don't know what's in your heart, but usually we were taught what's in your heart will shine on the outside. And if you would be willing to change, we have no right to say that's not okay.
What would your advice be for me if I was to ever consider sort of marriage at this age?
That's a good question. Look for a very decent, not wild, but decent and sincere girl. If she smokes or drinks, then you can probably tell too if she's a decent girl or not. You know what my mom always said?
What?
It is really funny, but it probably has something to do with. She said, if you want a nice, kind-hearted husband, watch how he treats his horse.
While James learns about the art of old Mennonite courtship, the girls are being taught the art of canning tomatoes, something all Amish and Mennonite ladies hold close to their hearts.
For most of us, it's important to have a property large enough to have a garden to raise food for our families, you know, to be able to preserve that food. We just think it's good to learn to kind of live off the land. Then you're not in such a pinch, like when the economy goes south or something.
Whilst I've been here, I've noticed that everybody is an individual, but you've come together to be in a community in which, you know, where you value every single person and try really hard to make sure they stay in your community.
You know, riches are fleeting. What is there to riches? They can be gone overnight. It happens sometimes. Mm. And so we don't really build onto earthly riches or anything. We build a secure community for our children, the community of tomorrow. Then when the children are older, they'll learn to work together for the good of the community. And if a community is all pulling together, you can really go places.
I would say I definitely come from quite a me generation. And again, I'm not saying that Mennonite society is perfect and it's got it completely right, but the fact they understand the value of community and they understand the value of sharing the wealth, you don't need to always think about me. I just think it says a lot about our society, really.
Us plain people believe we belong to a family much greater than the ones that simply share our houses. And every family is listed in the Mennonite directory.
Someone once dubbed it the Menopedia. Mennonite Encyclopedia. It's directory of all the members of our group throughout 8 different states, I believe.
Is everyone in your Mennonite community kind of listed in that book?
I don't know of anybody that is not in. When Elton asked me to be his girlfriend, I looked up his family in this book to see how old he is, how many siblings he has. I can find out a lot about anybody just by looking in here.
Do you know everybody listed in this book?
If I follow their family lines or look up their siblings or whatever, I never really run to a dead end. I always find a piece of the puzzle that links together.
Okay, I'm gonna put you to the test, okay? Wherever my finger is kind of closest to.
Oh, yes. I know where they live.
Right, who did I pick?
It's Laverne Reif and it's Leon Reif's son. Laverne's mother is Mary M. Sensnig, Moses Sensnig's daughter, and I know the Moses Sensnig family. Yeah. I went past their house all the time when I was a girl.
Me.
Can I do one?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm astonished.
Ooh, how about?
It's crazy.
That one. Lester Neuswanger. Oh, how many miles? They live about 3 miles from here.
I couldn't do this in Yellow Pages at all.
ready? Thanks, good job.
James has a soft spot for Darlene, but knows he can't do things the English way. He needs advice on the most appropriate way to approach a gentle lady.
Hi.
So yeah, I spoke to Rachel and we sort of spoke about dating a bit. And she said that had I turned up that day on our first day, sort of dressed the way I was and everything, coming to ask for a date with one of her daughters, she quite happily told me, yeah, I wouldn't have been allowed. So what about you then, Darlene?
As far as the piercings and stuff, I guess personally, you know, I definitely am not much into facial piercings. It tends to scare you a bit.
I guess, have you got any advice for me that obviously I could take back?
Well, I'd definitely say it's good to wait. You know, if you meet a girl, to me, I just think giving it time is so much more. It's such an important step, you know. If she's meant to be your girlfriend, I'd say she'll wait for you.
Yeah.
Our English friend's time in the gentle Old Order Mennonite world with the Burkholder family is slowly drawing to a close.
I think my general perspective on a lot of things has changed. Something that I'm clinging onto still is the idea of, you know, what makes you happy. And I wouldn't want to make a general kind of rule, but they definitely seem to be happy, and it does prove that, you know, the things that we hold high in our society is important. For example, education and being independent doesn't necessarily make you more happy.
As well as getting to know us plain people, our English friends have been getting to know each other, even though they're from very different backgrounds.
When was the last time you ate an apple?
Year four, I think.
Year four?
Yeah, my teacher made me do it and I threw up. Didn't like her after that.
I dare you.
I dare, yeah? I dare to eat apples.
To eat one of these. An apple a day keeps the doctor away, James, so.
Mm-hmm. Apples to good health.
Apples to good health.
It seems that time spent with us plain people has inspired our friend James to try a different approach to dating.
I went on a date with this girl sort of just before I left, and she seemed quite nice. I quite like her. So based on my chat with Rachel yesterday, sort of speaking to Jay, maybe the letter, would be quite a good thing to do. This is definitely probably the first time I've ever, you know, wrote someone a letter and sort of asking them out, I guess. Because I think it shows that you've taken your time, but I like to think that she'll say yeah, but sadly I won't sort of know till we get back to England. So you know, she might.
This modesty thing's really got to me. I think being surrounded by modest people has really got me thinking about some of the clothes that I wear. Mm-hmm. So I don't actually know if I want to wear these shorts anymore. But they did cost me quite a lot of money.
Yeah, but you have nice legs.
Yeah, but it doesn't mean you can get them out.
I definitely think Charlotte, I made her think a little bit, really, you need to wear short skirts all the time, show so much flesh. I think it really did kind of, you know, face her being with the Mennonites here for a couple days.
Obviously, I still will dress to impress on a night out, but I wear a see-through shirt sometimes, which shows my bra, and I don't think I'll be doing that. I think I'll cover up more. And I think perhaps guys will respect me more. I just want to go out there and be totally who I am. Makeup doesn't mean as much to me anymore, Sienna.
I like what I'm hearing from you, girl. Sean, like I said, I'm very proud of you. Lots of stuff.
The Book of Proverbs tells us that relatives are born to share our troubles, and a friend is always a friend.
All dressed up in your comfortable clothing.
They may look funny, dress funny, and have curious ideas about life. but our English friends may just be here to teach us something about ourselves.
I'm looking at James completely different than when I did when he crawled out of the van. I look at him completely different. I feel closer to his heart. He had values, and I just won't think about him the way I did the first day he walked in.
Aww. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having us. Yep. Good fun.
Hope to see you back sometime.
I got your address, and that would be nice.
Again, safe journey, and God bless.
I really enjoyed introducing them to my friend to see how we do as a youth group.
Bye.
Safe journey again.
It really made me appreciate what values we really have.
Okay, guys, you ready to work?
It's quite physical.
The true test is endurance. Once you do 5 or 6 loads, that proves whether you're a man or not.
I like housework.
I usually like to race with the clock.
It's such a good, optimistic way of looking at things.
What will your answer be to God when Jesus comes?
I don't think it's going to happen, so I don't really have an answer.
I see.
Was he looking after that? Did we just buy a horse?
If we would never forgive, I have no idea where our marriage would be.
Oh dear.
That next time is next Thursday at the earlier time of 8 o'clock. If you missed my Big Fat Gypsy Christmas this week, fear not. You can catch up with 4OD at channel4.com. Next tonight, Deck the Halls? Not so much. It's the concluding part of This Is England 88.